Recorded Books presents Warlord Born, The Great Insurrection, Book 1, by David Beers and Michael Anderle. Narrated by John Skelley. Prologue: The Written History of the Great Insurrection. My name isn't important. It has been and will continue to be spoken, but it truly doesn't matter much to this history. I follow, and there is no shame in that for me or any of the legions that do the same. The only important thing about me is who I follow. I stand next to a man who some call a devil, a demon. Others remember him as Odin or Alistair Kane. Some whisper Prometheus when they speak about him, saying he is a god who brings fire to humanity, while others only talk about how the Greek myth was doomed, as this man is. Perhaps it's all true, or perhaps none of it is. That isn't why I write this, to decide one way or another. I don't know how this story ends, neither does he. I only know that he won't quit, which means I will go to whichever destiny he races toward as well. Victory or failure, I will follow him. Whatever name history records, however it records his deeds, I will live or die with him. He is my friend, the greatest I've ever had. Perhaps he isn't the greatest of us all, but he is the one who leads, and while this isn't his story, it is he who will bring it home. Welcome to the Great Insurrection. Chapter 1. The Titans are the best of us, pure of heart, pure of body. They and they alone protect the Commonwealth from humanity's worst instincts. Aurelius De Finita, First Imperial Ascendant. Alistair Kane stood in the back of the elevator, his mech pulse primed to maximum power. Ares stood at his right, shoulder to shoulder, and two rookies in front of them. Alistair didn't know their names, and he didn't like that. Ares hadn't mentioned the two newcomers since the operation began, then saying only, "These are who Control sent." He didn't know the last time he'd performed an operation without knowing the details of every man or woman within his purview, but it certainly hadn't occurred during his time as Primus. "They know," he thought, as the elevator moved up another floor. "They know, and this is the end." Alistair's mech suit covered his entire body, practically a metal exoskeleton that turned even the slightest of his movements into a powerful force that could break concrete. It allowed four men to ride to the 500th floor of a skyscraper without fearing that they'd soon be fighting upwards of 100 combatants. Alistair's left hand held the mech pulse, while his right dropped and lightly touched his whip. It was attached to his mech suit, one of his oldest friends. He shouldn't need the weapon for this operation, but no Titan would enter an operation without it. "They know," his mind whispered again. "Control knows." But that would mean Ares knows, and there isn't any way they'd send him. He wouldn't hurt you, not in this life or the next. Alistair didn't turn his head to look at his protege, just kept staring forward. They had about 100 more floors to climb. By now, the subversives would know something was wrong. The building had been completely shut down. Their windows were no longer working, and attempts to fly vehicles to the top floor were being denied. Most likely, the subversives could see the elevator rising, at least digitally. Those on the top floor were probably preparing for the arrival of the Titans. Alistair always wondered what that felt like, knowing fate had decided your time to die was here, and you could do nothing about it. For Alistair and his Titans, there were less dangerous ways to go about putting these subversives down. They could have simply used the mech suit's jets to fly to the correct level, but that didn't fit the purpose. Control, indeed, the Commonwealth as a whole, wanted the subversives to understand they had no hope. Once they were found, the entire building they occupied quit obeying their commands and would only obey Control's. Thus, the elevator's slow creep upward, moving toward fate. The mech suits were climate-controlled. Alistair kept his at a crisp 65 degrees, regardless of his body temperature. Yet he felt a drop of sweat run down his brow. "You're scared," he thought, "and not of the subversives. You're scared they know, and if they do, then fate has come for you, hasn't it?" "Activate HUDs," Ares commanded from Alistair's right. He meant the heads-up displays that formed outside the mech suit's helmet, overlaying augmented reality onto whatever the Titan looked at. "Odin, you ready?" Odin was Alistair's call sign, and Ares was what the man next to him answered to. "Locked in," Alistair responded as the elevator rolled to a smooth stop. "Control," he said into the comm that linked back to the digital bay. "Open doors." Overhead, there was a soft ding, and the doors opened, splitting down the middle. The two Titans in front moved out, their mech pulses sweeping the area. Alistair and Ares stepped out next, Alistair's pulse at eye level, his fears from before gone. He had turned into his call sign, the name by which he was known as from one side of the world to the other, from Earth to the very farthest reaches of the Commonwealth, the ice planet Pluto. Alistair Kane was Odin, the modern-day god of war and justice. The HUD overlaying his vision showed heat traces where the subversives were scattering, running behind doors and down hallways, doing anything to stay away from the Titans, from fate. Alistair glanced to his right, noting that Ares was too close to him. At the same moment, he saw the elevator door had closed behind him. Both of those things were against protocol. Alistair didn't know if Ares realized he'd noticed, so he turned his pulse toward a door showing a subversive's traces. "There's no need," Ares said from behind. His voice was masked now, in case anything was being recorded. It would be impossible to tell who'd been inside the suit. "There's no one here, Odin. Just us." Alistair didn't turn around. He didn't need to. The room made sense now. His HUD couldn't see through this type of construction material, meaning he couldn't actually see the subversives, only their traces. And those had been placed here before the Titans began their trip up in the elevator. The other two Titans came back from their false chase. They'd only been awaiting Ares' signal. Alistair lowered his pulse so the barrel faced the ground. One of the strangers spoke.
"Careful, Odin. Don't think about grabbing that whip."
Ares' voice was like iron. "You're not here to talk, so don't do it again." Alistair knew why the stranger had spoken. He was scared. He knew of Odin, and he knew how much death Odin could cause if he unleashed the whip that was 2 inches from his fingers. Alistair dropped his head to the right so that he could half see his partner.
"You're going to kill me?"
"Is that supposed to strike a chord with me?" his partner asked. "I'm not going to kill you, Odin. You killed yourself when you listened to the subversives."
Alistair's eyes found the new Titans. Were they really Titans, or just people wearing suits to help finish the job? Control probably didn't think Odin was capable of what he'd done in the past, so they believed Ares could take him out by himself. Those two were most likely here to reinforce for Odin that he had no chance of survival. The newcomers stood 12 feet from him. A pulse hit from here would evaporate a human, but Alistair would survive inside the mech suit. It would be damaged, without a doubt, but he'd live.
"What do you think the subversives told me, Ares?" he asked, his body as still as a sphinx's.
His partner laughed, the sound distorted and evil.
"I don't have to think. I know exactly what was said because I watched it. Did you really think that blocker would work? Or that we didn't know you let them go?"
He shook his head.
"I will say it was a nice acting job, Odin, making it look like 3 subversives could take you and your whip down."
"You're sure of that?" Alistair said. "You're willing to bet my life on the fact that I let them go, that I was acting?"
Ares didn't lower his weapon an inch.
"Our institutes are based on your skill sets, your style of fighting and tactics. Where do you think I learned how to be a Titan? Simple subversives can't put you down. If they could, they'd have killed you."
Alistair's eyes were still on the newcomers, though his helmet kept them from knowing.
Did you listen to what they said? Did you do any checking?
Ares shook his head. No. I tracked them down and killed them yesterday. Any doubt I might have had about your complicity in their escape died with them.
What now? Alistair asked. What are your orders?
Another laugh from the person Alistair considered his second closest friend. A cruel laugh. One without mercy, without even a semblance of love.
You know what happens. You've done it to others who gave up the code. There's no need to rehash it here, is there?
I suppose not, Alistair whispered. He had done it to others for the exact reason they would now do it to him, because he had given up the code. They would kill him here and either have a fake public execution, or most likely say the great Odin had been slain by the All-Mother's subversives. Put it on her head to stir up more hatred.
And my wife? I'll make sure she's taken care of. She won't know of your betrayal.
It was the first sign of any humanity from Ares.
No more questions. Die like a Titan.
I expect nothing less, despite your fall. Alistair checked his breath and his heart rate. His HUD displayed them both, 77 beats per minute, respiration normal. Even now, his body wouldn't panic. It was part of what made the two newcomers fear him. In situations when the body should break, his remained calm.
Do Titans die, Ares? Or do we fall?
In your case, his friend answered, both. Alistair didn't think. His suit could handle one pulse shot, but not three at once. He dropped to a knee, let his pulse fall to the ground, and put his right hand on the whip. A shot passed overhead, and the wall on his left disintegrated. The two newcomers were pumping their pulses for a reload, but it was too late for them. Perhaps they knew it, perhaps they didn't. It was all the same to Odin. He grabbed the whip's hilt, and the genetic codes traveled to it as he pulled it free. No other hand, no other person could operate it, and as it read its master, the weapon flowed from the hilt. Red light flooded into three whip-like strands. It would be a beautiful thing to watch under other circumstances, but Odin had no time just now. He lunged forward as Ares' pulse disintegrated the wall he'd been standing in front of. The newcomers tried to raise their weapons, but he slashed his whip at them, and the red lasers sliced through the first man, cutting him in two. Odin spun around his remains to reach the second Titan. Ares' blast struck the second man head-on, damaging his suit. Odin raised his whip, and it responded to him without hesitation. The three individual strands coiled around one another as they wrapped three times around the newcomer's neck. The suit sizzled and started melting, but Odin didn't allow the strand to tighten further. Ares fired again, the mech pulse shattering the second newcomer's suit's knee joints. His suit wouldn't function any longer, at least as far as walking went. Stop, the stranger. He'd probably pissed himself. Odin stayed directly behind his hostage. Showing even an inch of his suit would put him at risk. Ares wielded the pulse like a surgeon.
You going to kill him to get to me?
The mech suit was too large to shrug in, so Ares raised a hand in an equivalent gesture. That's up to you. You're not surviving this, and however many people need to die to make that happen is on you. Ares nodded at the body that lay in two pieces on the floor. Odin whispered to the man in front of him,
I'm going to step back. If you don't move with me, your head is going to come right off your body. Nod if you understand.
The newcomer nodded, causing the whip to melt a bit more of his metal suit. Odin took a step back, and the soldier followed. His knees didn't bend, but his hip joints allowed him to shuffle awkwardly. Ares laughed.
Where do you think you're going? You're going to fly out the window? Try to get home to your wife and protect your house? You know there is no hiding from the Commonwealth. You think your wife hasn't already been detained?
Do you think she's at your house, Odin?
He shook his head. All the pieces were in play long before you got into that elevator.
Give it up. There is no valor in stupidity. Die like the Titan you were, the one you'll be remembered as.
Odin took another step. His HUD showed him the distance to the window behind him. This leap wouldn't be easy,
and regardless of what the newcomer had done, he didn't deserve to die right now. Odin didn't want to kill him, which added another layer of complexity to the maneuver. He hadn't thought about what came next, not truly. There hadn't been time. All he knew was he wanted to get to Luna, and from there, they could decide what to do. He wasn't going to listen to anything else Ares had to say. Odin gripped the whip tighter.
If Luna isn't at home, Ares, it's you I'm coming for next.
His left foot pushed off the ground while his right launched into the newcomer's back. The whip unfurled from the man's neck, and Odin threw himself toward the window. He turned in the air, commanding the three strands of his whip to uncoil. They began circling in a saw-like fashion. Odin heard and then felt the pulse shot from behind, part hitting the hostage and the other part slamming into him. The whip touched the window, and the three strands cut a circular hole just before Odin's helmet slammed into it. He felt another blast from the pulse, and his left boot's shield went down. His HUD showed it as red, but he wasn't inside the building any longer. Odin started his fall from the 500th floor, and he could see the entire world below him. The edges of his right boot blasted fire as the jet activated. He knew going up would be impossible with only one jet, so he let himself fall. The force of the blast sent him swerving to the left and launched him at an extra 30 kilometers per hour. Odin tilted his head back to the window and saw Ares look out. He wasn't aiming the pulse since he realized one of Odin's feet had been damaged. He could simply let the Titan fall to his death. Odin's HUD showed time until impact, and there wasn't any way he could slow down before he splattered all over the ground below. He looked over his shoulder and saw that Ares had him in his line of fire, obviously having decided not to risk any more mishaps. Odin twisted his foot to the left and gripped his whip. It connected instantaneously with him, and he had it spin its strands once more. The blast missed him by inches, though its wake threw him off course. The whip tried to adjust but wasn't quick enough, carving only a short way into the wall before Alistair's suit smashed through it. He slid on his back as concrete, metal, and bricks scattered before him. People screamed since the floor hadn't been emptied before the Titan's arrival. He laid on the ground, staring at the ceiling for a few moments, and his whip retracted into its handle, waiting for his next command. He pulled up his current location on the HUD. He'd dropped 300 floors, and by now, control would know where he was. There wasn't any way out of this, but he had to get to Luna. He rose to his feet as people rushed toward the doors and elevators. None were working, at least not in their favor. He scanned the crowd quickly, his HUD identifying everyone and showing no threats. Odin looked over his shoulder to see the hole in the wall, wind flinging loose papers around. That was the only way out. 200 floors down with a damaged mech suit. Think, he told himself. Could he carve his way out of here? The whip was strong, but multiple uses to cut steel would wear it out, possibly even break it, and that could not be risked. He knew reinforcements were coming. The elevators were moving, and he could hear quadcopters in the distance. Control hadn't thought it would take this much to kill him, but they were prepared all the same. He knew how they were following him. The mech suit. They'd be able to find him as long as he wore it. But could he survive without it? There wasn't any real choice. Fold off, he said into the helmet, and the suit collapsed into itself. Helmet went to neck, neck to shoulder, and so on until it had all compacted except for his damaged left boot. He used the whip delicately and cut himself loose. Then he stood up in standard armor, flexible black fabric that wouldn't hold up to a tenth of a pulse blast. To his right, he saw a man cowering behind his desk. He hadn't run. Odin turned to him. Give me your clothes, now. The man froze for a second, not understanding. Odin raised the whip and lashed with all three strands, blackening the floor beneath him. Your clothes! Odin didn't want to hurt these people. He didn't want to even scare them, but fear was his most potent weapon right now if he wanted to find his wife. Ares would have said anything upstairs to keep him from fighting back, but Odin didn't believe one word of it at the moment. The cowering man stripped quickly,
knowing from the armor and whip who stood in front of him, or if not who, then what? A Titan. Odin wished he had his HUD, but that was in his discarded mech suit. The man had stripped to his skivvies, and Odin quickly dressed in the discarded clothes, modern-day business attire. It would give him only seconds, but that was all he would need. He looked at the people huddling against walls, in corners, and under desks. I'm not gonna hurt any of you. Men are coming right now, and they will if you get in their way. Do not get in their way. When they get here, they're going to ask where I am. Don't answer. Odin knew that if any of these people lied to the Titans when they arrived, there'd be severe punishment. All you need to do is look out the hole in the wall. Nothing else. These people were fearful, but they also understood that Titans were on the side of justice. They most likely thought the men hunting him were subversives, so they would listen to what he told them. It would only be later that they'd realize they'd been duped, but he wouldn't care at that point. Odin pocketed his whip, now silenced, and shoved the undressed man beneath his desk. He followed, leaving the damaged boot where he'd once been. Seconds ticked by. Odin could smell the man's urine. He placed his hand on the stranger's shoulder, at the same time keeping his eyes on the still closed elevators. You're safe. Nothing's going to happen to you. Just stay right here. The man sniffled and nodded, his relief palpable. Odin moved his hand back to his pocket, gripping the silent whip. This was taking them too long. They should have already been here. The whine of the quadcopter grew louder outside. Odin thought he heard a second as well. They won't let me leave, he thought. The elevators opened. Odin recognized the first three Titans, Thor, Freya, and Mars. Ares walked out last, his red mech suit the color of blood, the only one of its kind. Where is he? Ares asked the cowering room full of people. He didn't need to specify who he was talking about, given the massive hole in the wall and the wind rushing through it. Odin watched as everyone slowly turned as he'd instructed. Ares nodded. Go, he told the other three Titans. Damn it, Odin thought. He didn't want Ares behind him under any circumstances. He watched as the Titans moved across the room, their boots thumping heavily on the floor. Odin quietly pulled the whip from his pocket, the hilt glowing red as it activated. The man next to Odin stared at it with a slack jaw. Whips were known throughout society, but rarely seen. Usually, if you saw one and weren't a Titan, death was imminent. The Titans went past the desk and peered out the hole. I don't see a, one started to say. Odin moved before they finished. He leapt from behind the desk, his whip's three strands falling out of the handle. They crackled with energy, which gave away his location, but the Titans were too slow. Thor moved first, turning his head over his shoulder, his own whip spilling out. Odin brought his down across the Titan's right arm, cutting it off in three different sections, the final one above the elbow. Blood spilled on the floor as screams ripped from the man. Mars was in the middle, and he formed his whip into a solid sword. It slashed across Odin's, trying to pin it to the ground. Odin's whip wrapped around Mars's sword, and he yanked. The Titan was pulled forward, but Odin couldn't attack him with his body. He'd break his hand or foot on the suit. Freya swung from his left, aiming for his midsection. He ducked, and the whip sizzled over his head. Mars had jumped back quickly to avoid Freya's whip. He now grabbed Odin by the throat with his left hand and thrust him into the air as he stepped in Thor's blood. Ares remained at the elevator. That's enough, Odin. There's nowhere to go. The mech suit's hand was impossibly strong, and it slowly strangled him as he hung in the air. Odin relaxed his whip, letting Mars go. The young Titan should have cut the older one's whip arm off at that point, but he didn't. He wanted to make a show, maybe for Ares, maybe for himself, to prove that though he was young, he'd been the one to capture Odin. He brought his whip, still in the sword form, up to an inch from Odin's eye. Some Titan, he mocked. Odin's vision was blackening at the corners, but that had happened before. He brought his whip up blindingly quick, wrapping it around the arm holding his throat. Go frag yourself. He couldn't see Mars's eyes behind the helmet, but he knew they were wide. The Titan had frozen instead of shoving his own whip into Odin's brain. Instead, he lost an arm. Odin yanked down on the whip, the three strands slicing through metal, flesh, and bone as if there were no difference between them. Mars stumbled backward and almost fell through the massive hole in the wall, but Freya shoved him just in time. He sprawled to the right, blood spraying across the floor. Odin realized his mistake too late. His flesh was ripped from his body in three long strikes as Ares' whip slashed him. His own blood now spilled, and he fell to his knees. Ares hadn't used the whip to kill, only injure. Enough! Ares shouted through his helmet. He brought the whip down again, more flesh burning away from Odin's body. This time it wrapped around his right shoulder, and Ares let it cut deep, carving into bone. Odin fell onto his hands and knees. Freya stood in front of him, her gray mech suit hiding the woman inside. Behind her, and just outside the building, the quadcopter hovered in the air. Wind ripped around Odin as blood leaked from his battered body. From behind, Ares ordered, "Clip him." Freya reached to her left leg and pulled out a clip, which was half a halo that would go on Odin's forehead, rendering his mind and body useless. They couldn't kill him, not in front of all these people. Control would have to change the narrative, though Odin didn't know how they would fix this mess, with the Titans missing arms and witnesses everywhere. "You're not done yet," he told himself. "If you're going to die, you're going to do it with Luna." He'd been the best once. Maybe he wasn't anymore. Maybe the man behind him slashing his back with a whip was now the stronger of the two, but Odin could still be the best for a moment. Freya approached, the silver clip shining in front of her. She bent slightly, her whip now extending only a quarter of the way outside its hilt. Odin's had retracted all the way, giving out as his body did. He felt the warm blood leaking down his chest, some of it his, some of it others. The clip was an inch from his head. He shoved forward, his muscles responding to his commands the best they could, and he flew through Freya's legs. He slid over the edge as she turned around, her whip slapping down a half second too late. Odin reached forward, and his hands gripped the quadcopter's nearest landing skid. The pilot hadn't expected the added weight and couldn't adjust in time. The copter tilted forward and to the right, one of its propellers slamming into the steel wall. Odin could hear nothing besides the whoop-whoop of the other propellers. Material crumbled from the wall and hit his already wounded back as the metal propeller bent but kept slapping into it. The copter started falling, dragging across the building as it did. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Odin couldn't look at the Titans above him. All he could do now was try not to die. The other front propeller was dragged into the wall, and the two together slowed the machine's slide. It had fallen another 50 floors or so, and Odin's hands were starting to lose their grip. His right side was far too weak to do this much longer, and despite the pilot's best efforts, there wasn't any way this thing wouldn't burn on the side of this building. He looked down. The drop was still too far. He'd break every bone in his body if he let go. The copter's tail was swinging, about to collide with the building. And then? He'd burn alive if he wasn't smashed into the steel first. Odin let go. The rush of wind immediately replaced the sounds of the propellers. His whip was still in his pocket, but it was meant to kill, not save. The building was 5 inches from his body, and if he tried to lean back, he'd drag across it before bouncing off, more of his body destroyed. 100 stories left. Luna, he thought. I love you. Odin's heart was still normal. 77 beats per minute. He never saw what he hit. He felt a momentary bright pain, as if a sun had enveloped his body. Then there was blackness. Chapter 2.
Those who wish to cause the Commonwealth harm, these subversives, must be eradicated at all cost. They have no place in our society. Aurelius De Finita, First Imperial Ascendant. Odin existed during certain times, those when death sprang from the Titan's hands like water from a fountain. The rest of the time, he was Alistair Kane. After his fall, he was no one. He existed in a world that no one else could see, one of intense pain and nothing else. No knowledge of where or who he was, no knowledge of the past, and no hope for the future. There was simply pain. He didn't know how long he was in that place, but toward the end, he started to hear voices. Alistair couldn't make out what they said. His mind couldn't piece together what any of it meant. He only knew that it was different from the pain. Next, he saw a jumble of light, blue and purple, some white. Words, noises, lights. Until he woke up. He felt the sting of the slap before he knew what was happening.
"Wake up,"
a gruff voice commanded.
"Wake up."
Smack. Flesh on flesh, the mark of the slap red across his face. Alistair blinked once, twice, and then peered into the world. The lights were bright on his eyes and he kept them narrowed. People stood on both his left and right, but their faces were blurred by dimmers. They looked pixelated and dark.
"Who are you?"
Alistair said, though his throat was on fire and he didn't know how clear his words had come out. The man on the left responded,
"Your guardian angels."
Alistair groaned. No citizen in the Commonwealth would talk about such an ancient concept. He had thought life could get no worse, with control issuing his death sentence. Now he had somehow been kidnapped by subversives. How many of them had he killed? How many had he clipped who were now in cryo? He couldn't count the number if he had untold lifetimes. Alistair knew what came next. Torture. Perhaps years of it, until he had told them everything he knew about control and the Commonwealth. Until he had made things up that had never existed and never could, but he would say them anyway just to make the torture stop. Alistair had seen subversive victims before, or at least what was left of them.
"Kill me,"
he whispered. The man on the left nodded.
"What if I could, bub? But it's out of my hands."
The man on the right waved a needle in front of Alistair's face.
"We need you to wake up, so I'm gonna give you a stim. You ever had a stim before?"
Alistair groaned again, turning his head against the pillow. He didn't know what the man was saying and didn't care. His legs, his chest, everything was on fire, as if someone had doused him in gasoline before tossing a match on him.
"Going to feel like someone put a mech card in your chest,"
the man said as he continued waving the needle in front of Alistair's face.
"You may want to try and attack us, thinking you can get out of here."
He looked at the bottom of the bed Alistair lay on.
"Your legs don't work no more. They're fragged. And your lungs are only pumping because of this."
He tapped a machine to Alistair's right, something he hadn't noticed. The man on the left spoke up.
"So don't try anything, bub. If we wanted you dead, you would be. Comprende?"
Alistair said nothing, still not understanding what was happening around him. The needle glistened in the light as it rose into the air. The man holding it spoke once more.
"We're hitting your heart with it because we need you wide awake. You won't feel a thing, though, so don't worry."
Alistair barely had time to register what the man was saying before the needle plunged into his chest. If he thought he was in pain before, he'd been wrong. Very wrong. Fire lit across his chest plate as the needle cut through bone, then punctured his heart. The man pressed the button on the side of the syringe, and the stimulant rushed into Alistair. His eyes sprang wide, his mouth opening into a scream that didn't come out. He realized he had no air in his lungs. He couldn't breathe. He sat up, pain breaking out across his lower body, hands grasping at the air.
The man on the left leaned over and swatted him hard on the back. His lungs opened, and air rushed into them. Relief washed over Alistair. He fell back in the gurney-like chair. The pain in his chest was still there, but fading. His eyes focused on his surroundings, years of training taking over without any effort. A light overhead, the rest of the room dark. A single door to his right. Man on his left wore no armor, but there was some kind of small plasma weapon holstered on his hip. Alistair tried turning around to see the man behind him.
"Don't strain yourself, bub."
The man walked around to the front of the chair, turning off the dimmer over his head.
"I'm not hiding from you, and I don't care if you see my face. You can't trade information with anyone on Earth any longer. Go ahead and tell Control you know who I am. It won't save your life."
Alistair understood now, the stim working on his brain as well as his body. He said nothing, knowing these people were subversives. There'd be no help here. He tried sitting up again, but the man on the right slammed him back down.
"Nuh-uh, bub. Right where you are is where you shall stay. Now listen to me, and listen closely. Him and me?"
He pointed between him and the other guy.
"We're the only two things that are keeping you alive right now. Personally, I think this is the worst decision I've ever seen, but I don't get much say in it."
He took a step back and pointed at the door.
"Out there is a ship waiting on you. Its only goal is to get you off this planet and out to the furthest reaches of the solar system. As close to safety as you're going to find now that your life is forfeit. But, bub, we don't force anyone to do anything. I won't put you on that ship if you don't want to go, so you have to decide if you want to stay on this rock or go to another. You stay here, you'll never see my face again. You'll never see his face again."
He nodded at his partner.
"We'll wheel you out of here, and then you're on your own. Comprende?"
Alistair was taking every word in, understanding it all after the stim. He glanced at the door, wishing he could get up, but he'd seen his legs, which were mangled and completely unusable.
Luna, he thought.
If he left, she was lost to him forever. The man on the left snapped his fingers in front of Alistair's face.
"Listen up, bub. Time is short, like real short. Your former friends are searching for you. They aren't going to stop any more than they stop when they hunt me and mine down. You go to the ship, or you..."
He looked down at the wreckage of Alistair's body.
"See how far you can run on the things you used to call legs."
Alistair laid his head back on the chair and closed his eyes. How had he gotten here? How was this his life? The thought that made up his mind was a simple one. If I stay, I'm dead. No Luna. If I leave, maybe there's a chance I see her again. It was the silliest of thoughts. One that ignored a galactic empire, 1,000 years of law, and the fact that he was now a broken man. Yet the thought possessed him like a virus, rapidly taking over his mind and decision-making capability. Without opening his eyes, he said,
"I'll go."
There were a few moments of silence, which caused Alistair to open his eyes. The two men were staring at each other, and Alistair realized that neither of them had thought he would agree.
"What is this all about? Why are you helping me?"
The man on the right stepped away from the chair and behind Alistair. When he came back into view, he was holding a gray blanket.
"The reason you're in this mess, Odin of the Titan Legion, is because you saved some of ours. The All-Mother knows you did, and it means she owes you a debt. The All-Mother pays her debts, no matter the cost. Apparently, even if it means saving a cockroach monster like yourself. Don't mistake either of us here. We don't like you. I'd kill you now if I could, but that's not my decision to make."
He took a step closer and lifted the blanket.
"This is what's going to happen. I'm throwing this over you, and we're walking out of this building. You're not to move because you're a corpse,
and we're transferring you. We've got the paperwork in order, so unless you rise from the dead, this shouldn't be a problem.
The one on the left, the man not holding the blanket, leaned close to Alistair's face.
If you decide to rise, thinking you can somehow save your skin by turning us in, I'm going to slit your throat faster than you and your pretty whip can possibly imagine.
At the mention of his whip, Alistair's hand automatically moved to his side, where it was always kept.
Don't worry, Titan, the man whispered. We've got it. The All Mother said to keep it for you. Now lay the fuck down so I don't have to look at you anymore.
Whatever they were doing for Alistair, it wasn't out of love. Their faces held nothing but hate and disgust. They would murder him if they were allowed. Alistair laid his head back down on the chair, and the man on the right pressed a button, allowing the top portion to recline backward. They draped the gray blanket over him, then the gurney started to move. Alistair listened with ears that had been trained to detect the slightest danger. He heard every turn of the wheels below him, as well as the footfalls of the men pushing him. He listened for words and other noises, anything that might give him a clue as to where he was. He didn't have any idea how being a corpse was going to get him on an interstellar flight. Off-world body transfers did happen when all of someone's relatives had left Earth, but now? During a manhunt? The man had lied to Alistair about one thing. They hadn't just given him a stim, at least not the normal kind. His brain was alert, but his body felt numb, so some kind of speedball was in effect. Alistair could only hope they'd gotten the dosage correct. The gurney came to a stop. Alistair's breathing was as slow as he could make it. This was something Titans trained for, and he was the best at it, with virtually complete control over his bodily functions. All the same, corpses didn't breathe, and if anyone looked at the wrong moment, there wouldn't be a whole lot he could do. The man who'd called him Bub spoke first.
Off-world, Mars. Approval orders?
The voice was stern, no nonsense, and control wouldn't have it any other way. Interstellar travel was constantly used by subversives, and they often used interdimensional travel. They all had to start here in the third dimension. Thus, control made sure only the most detailed-oriented Commonwealth servants were placed in positions to monitor it.
Here,
the man who'd held the syringe said. Alistair knew he was handing over a data track. It would have all the necessary approvals and orders to get them through. Or it wouldn't, and all hell would break loose. Seconds passed, and Alistair could feel the drug's effects starting to wane. He wasn't worried about brain fog or anything of that nature, but rather the pain in his legs. He remembered, or at least thought he did, them saying something about his lungs, that they weren't working anymore either. He didn't know about that, but he knew they had to quickly get him somewhere with solitude. Even his mastery of his body wasn't going to be able to shove this kind of pain away. He tried to think of his wife, to focus on her face, on her laugh. He tried to think of the way she smiled when she was teasing him, the little curvature of her lip as it pulled up, the way her eyes sparkled when she knew her wit was quicker and he wouldn't be able to tease back fast enough to matter.
Is there a problem?
The question pulled Alistair from his thoughts. He thought Bub had asked it, but he wasn't sure.
Problem?
The immigration agent responded, his voice sounding like he wasn't used to being challenged, but he was up to it all the same.
Yeah, Bub, problem. I come and go through immigration at least 3 times a year, sometimes more if I'm not going interplanetary. I've never seen anyone take this long over a simple body transfer, and from what I hear on the holosphere, there's a war zone downtown, so yeah, is there a problem? I need to get this body on ice before it starts smelling.
The pain was growing, and Alistair's need for oxygen was increasing.
If there's a problem, the immigration agent said, it sounds like it's your problem. You'll wait until I'm ready to let you go.
Alistair's ability to think was fading.
his body's need for morphoids and oxygen surpassing anything else. "Let me see the body." The immigration agent stood up. One of the men sighed. "You've got to be kidding me." Alistair's heart rate didn't increase, nor did his breathing, but he didn't know how he was going to fake looking dead. Pallor, skin suppleness, and a dozen other things separated a dead body from a live person, none of which Alistair could manipulate. Someone grabbed the corner of the blanket and lifted. Alistair knew his naked body was visible to all. He kept his eyes closed, his breath held inside his chest, hoping against all odds that somehow he wouldn't be recognized. That somehow his damned face wasn't plastered on every hollow wall in the city. One of Alistair's men asked,
"He looked dead enough for you?"
"Cover him up," the immigration agent instructed. "You're cleared." The blanket flipped back over Alistair's body, and the gurney started moving again. The shot they gave him must have done something to his lower body as well as his inner, but he couldn't consider that right now. Alistair waited for a few minutes, then whispered,
"Need stim."
"What you need," someone answered from above, "is to not say another word. We're not out of the woods yet." Alistair's hand bore down on the metal beneath him to keep from screaming as the wreckage of his legs demanded to be heard.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.